There we go. We got some more peoples coming in. Welcome, welcome, welcome.
Great.
All right. So anyone, do you want to introduce me first? Or do you want me to play the video first?
I'll introduce you first. I mean, unless you want to break out in a dance, because I think that'd be pretty cool.
Well, I'm not going to dance, but other people might, you know. Well, we won't be able to see them dance because they don't have their cameras on, so.
All right. Well, I will go ahead and record you. Try to keep an eye on who's joining there, or go ahead and introduce you, not record you. We are recording everybody today, though, just so everyone knows up front. And that way, if folks miss it, they can go to the website and check it out later. But anyway, welcome to our October Lunch and Learn. I'm glad you guys could join us today. I'm going to introduce Phillis Lewis. Phillis was born in Chicago, but raised in Memphis. She's a graduate of the University of Memphis with a BA in criminal justice and criminology. She comes with years of experience, not only working with the LGBTQ plus community, but has many years of experience in case management, grant monitoring, trauma-informed care, housing monitoring, and facilitation. Beginning her career at the Shelby County District Attorney's Office, where she worked there for almost 9 years. She is the current president of the Memphis Shelby Domestic and Sexual Violence Council, committee member for the Inclusivity Committee for the Tennessee Coalition to End Domestic and Sexual Violence, and the LGBTQ representative / vice chair for the Governing Council for the Memphis and Shelby County Homeless Consortium. Phillis is the former vice president of Mid-South Pride, which provides a yearly festival for the LGBTQ plus community that is diverse, inclusive, and community friendly to over 25,000 attendees. And as the CEO of Love Doesn't Hurt, Phillis Lewis works to help provide emergency services to victims of crime in the LGBTQ plus community, addressing barriers this population faces while seeking social services and helping to educate providers and the community to practice cultural humility. Phillis, take it away.
Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Thank you guys so much for joining us this afternoon during your lunchtime. Hi, Regina. For those of you who have never attended one of my meetings that I normally I'm over for the council. I'm a music person, so I enjoy music and I try to tie it into things that I am doing to kind of, you know, bring your spirits up. So I am going to share my screen and put the sound on. And let's see. I'm gonna play a little disco. Thank you. I hope you guys were dancing in your seats like I was, because I enjoy the disco. I think it definitely, yes, boosts the mood and gets you in the groove. The disco was definitely a time frame where, you know, just happy music and everybody was having a good time. So my presentation today is going to be focusing on Black and LGBTQ+, talking about stigma, stereotypes, and barriers. So Chloe already introduced me, so I don't have to go through all this stuff, but you can see my face, you see who I am, so we're good. So what exactly does Love Doesn't Hurt do? We help to provide emergency resources to the LGBTQ plus community. We provide educational sessions and presentations. We do this while promoting equality, empowerment, and love, and we help to provide inclusive and diverse assistance to victims and survivors. So here is our contact information. We have a website. We also have Facebook, Instagram, and we also have our info email address, and our phone number is there too as well. And you can support us through our website, PayPal, Cash App, things like that. And we're always looking for volunteers to help us spread awareness throughout the community. One thing I wanted to touch on is that there's just so much going on right now. So you want to make sure that you're taking a mental break for yourself, a break from news, friends, family, social media, anything that can help give you peace in the moment, because mental health is real. And you need to make sure that you're getting some self-care in and taking that time and space for yourself. And if you need any self-care resources or any ideas, feel free to reach out to Love Doesn't Hurt. So some housekeeping things. This is an informational session to introduce you to the barriers that may impact how you assist Black or POC, people of color, in the LGBTQ plus community, which is lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, queer, and plus community. We understand that, you know, these techniques or suggestions that we give, they're not going to work for every single party, and you may have to make some adjustments based upon your agency's capacity and what you're able to do. But if you have any questions, please use the chat box. Myself and Chloe are going to be keeping a lookout on that as I'm walking through everything. And then remember that this is a safe space. This is Vegas. Well, somewhat Vegas, because we are being recorded. But I'm saying it's a safe space. So if there's something that you don't want necessarily for people to know that you said, send me a private message or send Chloe a private message, and we will keep you anonymous as we answer your question. And just remember, no stigma, just love. We're all here to learn as much as we possibly can to be able to do better by the communities that we're serving. So the first thing that I want to talk about is checking your bias. Like, everyone has a bias, even though you may not want to admit that you have one. But when it comes to certain populations and groups and target groups, there are certain biases that happen in how these groups are being categorized or characterized in how they operate. So when society normally characterizes people who are Black and LGBTQ+, what are some of the things that come to mind? And I want you to use the chat box to give some descriptions as to how you have heard or seen individuals from the community be described. Loud. Okay. Anything else outside of loud? Sassy, angry, extra, aggressive, in your face. Yes. Petty. flamboyant, mm-hmm, fierce, traumatized, okay, emotional. Those are some good ones. All right, so I'm gonna go to the next slide. So when usually people are categorizing individuals in the LGBTQ plus community, especially the Black community, there are these stereotypes, you know, that people picture as to how a person that is a part of this community, what they look like and envision that. So some of you may tell your age by answering this question, but who can name the individuals that are in these pictures that you see on the screen? If we were in person, I would give you candy, but you know, we're virtual. So we got RuPaul. Okay. That's one. The Brat. All right. Marsha P. Johnson. All right. What about my guy at the bottom? Mama Ru, the mother of the movement. Yes. Anybody know who? Yes, so someone got it from the mannequin. Okay, so that's Hollywood from the mannequin. He was like the designer of the mannequins in the store. And yes, he was in designing women too. So these are, you know, so the stereotypes that you, no, that's not his real name is, I forget what his real name is. I just know him as Hollywood, but the mannequin is like one of my favorite movies. So with RuPaul, like, you know, identifies as a gay man, but wears, you know, drag. And so, you know, when people think about RuPaul, they don't think about RuPaul as a man. They think as RuPaul of, you know, a boy wearing a dress. And then, you know, with Hollywood, people saw him as this very flamboyant, you know, gay man. And with the Brat, you know, she was that masculine lesbian, and all lesbians do not present as being masculine. And then you have Marsha P. Johnson, who is, yes, the mother of the movement, and all, you know, individuals from the transgender community don't have, they don't have, you know, passing attributes to them. Yes, Billy Porter. I love Billy Porter. I'm going to get to that later. So then I wanted to switch to individuals that you can't necessarily look at and tell that they are a part of the community, that they are LGBTQ+. So who are some of these individuals that you see in the pictures? Don Lemon, Michael Sam, Laverne Cox, Wanda Sykes. See, you guys were on it. So, you know, these are individuals that you, if they were not famous and you walked up on them on the street, you would not automatically be able to identify that they were LGBTQ+. It would just look like another individual that you see on a normal day basis. And that's how the community wants to be seen. They, you know, they don't want to be seen as the stereotypes. They want to be seen as we are just normal individuals living our day-to-day life, interacting with people just like anybody else. So why are we here? So we're going to have an open discussion about the unique impact that heterosexualism and anti-Blackness has on Black LGBTQ plus survivors, and also rethinking how we provide advocacy to address the diverse needs of all survivors that we come in contact with. So who does your agency serve? When you think of the people who are walking through your doors virtually, for some, or for agencies that are having those in-person services, who are the majority of your services geared towards? And I'm looking for gender and race. Who is the majority that you see? So I see LGBTQ, older adults, college students, Black man seeking man of color, mostly female presenting, college students 18 to 25, male and LGBTQ rural survivors, mostly white, African American college students. And so with the majority that you serve normally will impact the way that your programs are set up. So in focusing on that, just making sure that you leave room and you make space for those vulnerable populations that may not necessarily be the main focus of your agency, but making sure that they know that your agency is a safe place that they can come to gain those resources and that assistance. So now let's look at oppression. So we're going to talk about oppression in four different ways. The first way is the systemic, the lies and the misinformation that are given about a particular target group. Like as you guys were touching on earlier, when it comes to the LGBTQ community about how they're loud and flamboyant and in your face and aggressive. Those are those misconceptions that people say about certain groups to make people feel a certain way or feel like they can't engage with that group or make them seem like bad people when they're not necessarily bad people. But it keeps sometimes people from wanting to get to know them because of the stereotype that comes with that. And then there's pervasive, that it happens so much that it becomes a norm that you have. I'm constantly getting discriminated against everywhere I go. And so that's just the way that I'm used to it being. So it's kind of like, it's just part of my daily activity at this point that I'm so used to it because it happens all the time. And then institutional, the mistreatment of a targeted group members that occurs in all social institutions. And this can be in regards to physical health, mental health, social services, and in other aspects as individuals are trying to seek resources or gaining access, being targeted because of their identity and who they are. And internalized is also in you, how you see yourself, how you picture yourself when you look into the mirror. And sometimes we can put things, what's the saying, that you are your own worst critic, that you can be harder on yourself than anybody else could ever be. And sometimes that happens in conjunction with all of the other forms of oppression, that you start to believe the things that people are saying about you. So let's dive into intersectionality. So with this, it focuses on that as a person, that you have all of these things that can impact the way that you can receive services and the barriers that you face. So how exactly do you think that some of these different categories could impact someone who is Black and identifies as LGBTQ+. What are some barriers that you think that they may come in contact with because of their race and their identities? And you can put those in the chat box. Don't be shy now. I know y'all out there. We'll start calling on folks. More likely to be victims of hate crimes. That is correct. A couple of years ago, there was an increase in hate crimes that happened. I think it adds to their invisibility that they're constantly being pushed. That's definitely a thing. So in regards to culture and race, when it comes to the Black LGBTQ plus community, think about families that with families and how much it can be stigmatized in the African-American culture of identifying as being homosexual. And the violence and the aggression that could be shown towards if you have someone that is beginning to identify as a gay Black male or identifying as being trans, and how their family would react to that. And then also with education, not being taught, you know, that there are options. And so some of the things you guys are hitting on, talking about isolation, being isolated from your friends and your family because of who you are, not accepted, seen it as an embarrassment, you know, shunned by your family because you identify as being gay or lesbian, bisexual or transgender or any other orientation, not being seen as Black enough or LGBTQ enough. That definitely happens. There's definitely biphobia. Used to be more taboo, family abuse, that all kind of ties into it. And so the more of these that you have, the bigger the challenge it could be when it comes to gaining access to resources. Because it's not just one thing that you have to worry about. It is a collective of many things that make it harder for you to get the help that you need and getting access to the help that you need. And so that's something that you want to be mindful of as you're engaging individuals who fall into these categories and making sure that you're paying attention to these things as you're trying to develop a plan of action with them. So what are some barriers that the community is facing? I was talking to Chloe earlier about this, and I was like, people love statistics. So I wanted to make sure that I put some out there for you guys. So 65% of Black transgender women will experience sexual violence. So the lifespan of someone who identifies as transgender and they also are Black, their life expectancy is 35. I'm 35. And to think that someone who identifies as transgender, just because they identify as transgender and they also are Black, that their life expectancy is 35. Yes. Wow. That is a heavy burden to bear. And like someone was saying earlier, like when you get to the point where you say that you're going to live in your truth and that you're going to come out and you're going to tell people this very personal thing about yourself. I saw something on Twitter and it said, when you choose to live in your truth, you are choosing happiness over safety. So you're choosing to be happy versus being safe by not letting people know. Because as soon as they know, then that puts you in danger. And so you want to be mindful of that when you are servicing individuals who identify as Black and are part of the LGBTQ plus community. So in 2015, they did a US transgender survey. And from this survey, they found that 61% of transgender respondents who interacted with the police had been harassed, had been assaulted, or otherwise mistreated. So if you have about 65% of Black transgender women who are going to experience sexual violence, statistically, they do not go seek services. And so you see why the number and the percentage of how many of them are mistreated by law enforcement will tell you why. Why would I go to seek services or help through this system if every time I come in contact with them, there's a problem? And it definitely is different, difficult for males too as well. There are studies that show that Black LGBTQ identifying male, they are at a higher rate of being victims of domestic violence as well. And I think that's one of my later points. So if you want to take a look at it locally, so Sister Reach is an organization that focuses on reproductive justice. And so they did a study a couple of years ago, and it focused on finding out the relationship that the lesbian, bisexual, transgender, and queer plus women had when it came to law enforcement. So out of the 73 participants that they had that participated in this particular study, only 3 of them said that they felt safe with reporting something to the police. A lot of the feedback that they gave said that they did not feel safe when the police came to the scene. In an incident that occurred with one of the participants, they advised that they had gotten into a physical altercation with their significant other, and the police arrived to the scene and called the incident a catfight. So if this is the engagement that happens with law enforcement, Why would I call for help if I'm not going to be treated fairly when they arrive? And so this creates that disconnect where the individuals need the help, but they don't go get it because of the experiences that they're having with the institutions and the systems that are supposed to be there to help, but are more so doing harm and deterring them from wanting to get those resources and that assistance. So over 50% of Black, gay, bisexual, or queer identifying men will experience domestic violence. And from some of the groups that I've spoken with, male groups that I've spoken with, they have said that a lot of the reasons why they don't speak to the police is because they are judged as to when they do talk to the police about what happened. They're like, well, how did you let that happen? You're supposed to be a man. How did you let somebody overpower you instead of treating them like they are the victim in the situation? And Kathy, you said trans people who are jailed are usually not housed according to their gender. And that's correct. And that puts them in danger of being sexually assaulted in prisons. Now in Shelby County in Memphis, the process that they have that they go with is that they will, even though they don't house the person according to their gender identity, they will ask them whether or not they want to be put in isolation or if they want to be put in general population. But even in that, why would someone willingly go into isolation? That mentally takes a toll on someone to be isolated from any type of socially interaction with anybody. And yes, Rachel, being isolated is inhumane, and it should be definitely some other practices that are put into place. And then police brutality. When it comes to the African-American community, feeling safe when it comes to the police is a thing, especially if you have watched the news at all recently. Seeing the interactions when it comes to the police is ridiculous. And to be not only Black, but also LGBTQ plus on top of that, it can definitely be paralyzing to be concerned about your interactions with the police and how you are engaging with them. There are some organizations that we have here in Memphis that promote like safe sex practices, and sometimes they'll go on to into the areas where there are a lot of transgender sex workers, and they will hand out like safe sex kits, and they will get harassed by the police and threatened to be arrested just because they're trying to provide information in safe sex kits to the sex workers. And so it's definitely policy changes and outlooks that need to be changed, and conversations that need to be had in order to help change mindsets. So, and with that, you have to change what your advocacy looks like. What does our advocacy look like? What are we doing and how are we helping? If we see a client from a particular group, how are we engaging them? I see a question. Why do you think the population distribution is way more heavily in the South for Black LGBTQ folks? I think because there's more of a sense of family when it comes to the South. And then like your religion, you have Atlanta, which has a huge population of Black LGBTQ folks. And it's a more welcoming area for people of color. And so people go where they feel welcome. And even though with being close to the Bible Belt, you will still have individuals that identify as being a part of the community. And even though their families may not agree with their lifestyle, they still want to be close to them anyways, to have that sense of connection to them. And so I that's my opinion as to why I think that happens. And you have this congregation of individuals in the South. So when doing your advocacy and doing the great work that you guys are doing, I hear all the time that people say, we will treat everyone the same that walks through our doors. We will not treat anybody any differently. And I think that this is a good sentiment to have, but it is not good in practice, because when it comes to when you're dealing with survivors and victims, that one size does not fit all. You need to make sure that you're making adjustments to the clients that you are coming in contact with, because what may work for one individual may not work for another individual. Be aware and be active. Be aware of your privilege and be active in combating discrimination and oppression and providing that allyship in
being a supporter to the clients that you have and creating that safe space for them as you're rendering the services. Let them define it. Let them define their trauma. Do not put your feelings on them of how they experienced it. Let them use their own words to say what happened to them. And this will help you to build a better rapport as you are working through crisis intervention. So that way you're not over talking them, that you're allowing them that space. And then also remembering that system-based response may not be the best option. If someone does not have a good experience with law enforcement or with the criminal justice system, bringing the police in the room with them may not be the best idea. You may have to rethink how your advocacy is going to look and what's the best route to go. And then also being mindful of referrals. When you're referring a client to a particular place, is this place welcoming to all and not some? Is this a place that you have a relationship with where you can do a warm transfer over? So that way, if you do have someone that identifies as trans, that they're not being misgendered when they go to this place, or if it is a shelter that may not be welcoming to individuals that identify as LGBTQ plus and may mandate that they participate in some religious practice or something. You want to make sure that you're being mindful of where you're sending people. And that's very important because when it comes to referrals in the LGBTQ community, a lot of it is done through word of mouth. And this is how people find out about your organizations, because they've been told by someone else in the community as to whether or not this is a safe place that I can go. If I've been told by people in the community that your place is not safe, it's not welcoming, it's not affirming, then I'm not going to go there. I'm not even going to test the waters. I'm going to go by what people have told me, that this is not a place that is for people that identify like me. So when you're engaging with a client and you're trying to figure out what is the best way for you to show up for them, what is the best way for you to help them? So what are some questions that you would ask them to get a better idea of how you could support them as an advocate? And you can put those in the chat box. What are your pronouns? Yes. And when you're asking their pronouns, when you're introducing yourself, you can use your pronouns to let them know that you acknowledge that their appearance may not match the pronouns that they identify by. And you're creating from the top that you're being respectful and that you're creating an affirming and welcoming place. What are some other questions that you can ask? Well, now we got all these advocates in the room. You mean to tell me you guys don't know what questions you need to ask? What are some usual questions that you ask your clients when you're, here we go. Do you have a safe place to go when you leave here? Yes, that is a great question. What would you like to be called? Yes. That is a very good question, because the name on their ID may not match the name that they prefer to be called. And so to make them feel safe, to make them feel accepted, what would you like me to address you as? How would you like me to address you? What does your support system look like? Friends, family, do you have people that, who cares about you? Who is going to support you outside of me? I tell people to think about the web of five. And if you don't have five people, that's just fine. But who are the people that if something happened to you, these were the people, these would be people that you would reach out to that would be there to help you. Good. Tell me about your last week. Where did you stay? Did you get food? What did you do? Those are good questions to figure out like what their mental state is and what their experiences have been, where their mood is. So that way you can know what direction you need to go in to as you're doing your case management. What do you need most right now? How can I be best supportive to you? What are your needs? How can I support you? Very good. See, I told you, you guys got it. Round of applause. Yes. Do you feel comfortable meeting here? Yes. Being comfortable in a space is very important. If a person is not comfortable, if they do not feel safe, they are not going to disclose anything to you. Because disclosing, as we have talked about earlier, it puts a person in danger. If I am disclosing this very personal thing about me, then what are you doing? How are you making me feel safe? If on the phone, if we get disconnected, what's a good number to call you on? Is it safe for me to call you on this number? I had an experience that I called a survivor and I asked them, was the number safe to call? And they advised that it was. And when I called them back, the person that picked up the phone was not affirming of their identity and kept referring to them as their birth gender versus the gender that they identified as. I'm white. Do you feel you can trust me as I present, or is there someone else that you would feel more comfortable working with? Yes, that's very good, Regina. You may not have the capacity, or they may not feel you have the capacity to be able to help and assist them. Trying to find them a support group that not only
I believe we lost our speaker for just a minute. I'm going to give her a few minutes to see if the tech issues sort themselves out.
I lost you guys.
There she is.
I thought you guys left me. All right. It says you disable screen sharing.
That fix it?
Yep, I'm good to go now. There we go. Do you have a safe word for follow-up calls or safety planning purposes? Yes, that's very good. So in our scenario, you have a client that you have been working with for months, trying to find a group for them, a survivor's group that is trans inclusive, and that they wanted to go a more private route. So they want to be able to use their insurance. So you finally found a group that takes their insurance and you refer them to this particular group. And then when you do your follow-up with your client, probably like 2 to 3 weeks later, they advise you that they did go to the group that you referred them to, but the facilitator of the group used very transphobic language and continued to call them by their dead name. And for those of you that do not know what a dead name is, that is someone who identifies as trans or even non-binary, that will be the name that they were given as birth. And usually as they are transitioning, they will change their name. So how would you address the situation after your client has disclosed to you their experience in going to the group that you referred them to? And you can put that in the chat box. First, validating the pain of the experience for the client. Yes, very good. Letting them know that their experience is valid and that you are affirming that what happened is bad, is wrong, that it shouldn't have happened. Anybody else? Were you guys over there typing up a storm and that's why I don't see it? Affirming the feeling felt, follow up with the group facilitator to discuss concerns and help the client find another group. Very good. Probably make some kind of formal complaint about the group. Accepting blame for giving the referral without realizing that this could take place. Yes. Working with them to find other appropriate resources. Apologize for making the referral, which was apparently uneducated. So yes, you want to make sure that you're also accepting accountability too on your part, and but also taking steps to rectify the situation. And how can I help you find a safe place for you in moving forward? And that will help to regain the trust of your client. Very good. Round of applause for you guys. Yeah, see, you guys are so smart. So, this month, there were two different national days for the community. You had National Coming Out Day, and then yesterday was National Pronoun Day. So I saw this really interesting video, and it talked about inviting in versus coming out. So I wanted to share this video with you all. And if you had any questions or anything like that after the video, we can go over that. So I'm going to share my entire screen, make sure my sound is on.
Hello, everyone. I am asking for your help in us taking back the United States Senate by chipping.
I would be okay with the idea of coming out if it meant that everyone was expected to come out. But that's not how it works in practice. I've never seen a heterosexual person have to tell their coming out story. My name is David Johns. I'm the executive director of the National Black Justice Coalition. And this is a word about inviting in. Inviting in is a way to complicate what is normally thought about as coming out. For many, coming out is the process by which people sit down, their families have an awkward conversation about them being LGBTQIA+, and then they're celebrated for it. Often for white people who come out, this also then involves them moving to a gayborhood, a place like Chelsea, New York, or Hollywood, California, or Boys Town, Chicago, where they then get to join communities and sports teams and show up in gay community centers where they draw power from that part of their identity. For those of us who are Black and LGBTQIA+, the idea of coming out is sometimes simply not an option. Most Black LGBTQIA+ people live with other Black people. We are disproportionately concentrated in the South. We live in the states where it is legal to discriminate against us based on actual or perceived sexual identity, gender orientation, or gender expression. We use the term inviting in to highlight the importance of people doing the work to show up as both allies and accomplices, adopting the language that we need to be able to talk about people in asset-based, stigma-free, positive ways to otherwise engage in conversations about things that are important to people. And so for us, the idea of inviting in people means that once you do the work required to demonstrate that you are competent and compassionate, I can share with you, or we can share with you, parts of who we are, including who we love, or other things that you might need to know about our identities. An example of inviting in is my brother Lil Nas X. Many people felt that it was important to talk about Lil Nas X having come out as if there was this singular moment in time in which he had this unique realization about his sexual identity and then decided to stand atop a mountain and decry it to the world for everyone to know. And what I appreciate most is that Lil Nas X says actually that's not true. He made clear for anybody that had questions who he is and how he shows up in the world as a Black man who happens to be same gender loving. Words matter, right? Inviting in as a construct is important because it highlights the importance of a bilateral relationship and the need for two people to be engaged in this process of having conversations and making space for each other. I don't owe you an explanation of who I love. If you do the work required to learn some language, to leverage our friend Google, and to again think about diverse experiences, then we might be able to engage in this conversation where I will invite you in. And the hope is that if I invite you in, you will invite me in as well, and we can have conversations about things that are important to you, but might otherwise be difficult for you to think about discussing. I have two hopes, dreams, goals with shifting from coming out to inviting in. And one is that we get to a point in time in which it's not necessary for anyone to have to explain or announce or defend their sexual identity, gender orientation, or expression. And more than anything, I hold this dream for our babies. Right now, high school kids are identifying more often as anything other than strictly heterosexual. And to be clear, there is no gay agenda. If there is and you've seen it, send it to me. But it is, I think, their way of saying to us that the boxes, the narrowly constructed categories that have existed for far too long, boy, girl, black, white, things that don't allow for these intersections to exist don't work for them. And so my hope is that we listen to the fact that our babies are screaming for us to do differently, to celebrate humanity, to otherwise find ways to strengthen cohesion so that we can be better communities and a better country. I believe that inviting in will hopefully be a tool to help us get there.
All right. So I really enjoyed that video because I think that it touched on points of making sure that you're creating an affirming environment. So instead of clients having to come out to you and tell you what their identities are, you're making them feel comfortable by using the language that they use within their communities to let them know that you are a safe person to speak with and that they can feel comfortable with you to be able to express themselves and feel safe and welcomed in the environment that you have created. And that's definitely very, very important. So that is it as far as like my PowerPoint and things like that go. But you guys have any questions or anything like that? For me, I'm gonna share my contact information in the chat so that way you'll have it. But there's 22 of us that are in here, so if you have a question or anything like that, you can actually unmute yourself. If you don't feel froggy to unmute yourself, you can put it in the chat box too. We'll do it either way. All right. Well, I guess we don't have any questions. I want to thank you guys so much for attending today and spending your lunch time with us. Chloe, I think we did good timing. It's like 1:26.
Absolutely perfect. Perfect as always.
Thank you. And I hope you guys have a great day. And if you have any questions or anything like that, definitely feel free to reach out to me. We're here to help and support any way that we can.
Yes, thank you all so much. Y'all have a great day. And Phillis, rounds of applause. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bye, everybody.
Bye.